Hey there, this is Paul and Nancy.
Hey there.
You know, we just ran into some friends again that we met,
A couple of months ago.
Yeah, a couple months ago.
Fellow Airstreamers.
And we met them here in Alpen Rose RV Park outside of Durango, Colorado.
It's always nice to get together with people that you've met and you get to see them again on the road.
That's the first time ever doing that, and it was pretty awesome. Got a chance to know them a little better.
So what we did was we shot a little video, kind of like a Q&A about them, so that you guys could get to know them just as much as we did. So check it out.
Yeah, okay, really... so we are here with family called, on the internet, called Alumalarkey. But come to find out, it has nothing to do with their name. I thought their last name was Malarkey.
it was just a bunch of malarkey.
That's right. This is Brea, Shannon, Quinn, and Callum. Thank you all for letting us into your home tonight.
Absolutely.
We would just like to find out a couple of things about you. Most importantly, what were you thinking? You lived in a beautiful home in Maryland and you gave it all up for, what is this, 200 square feet?
If that.
Tell us why.
The short story is that we had wood floors put in our house and we were... We weren't able to get in for 3 weeks, so we lived in our then Rockwood RV in our driveway for about 3 weeks, and we had minimal stuff. The boys had one bit of toys, and it was awesome. And we started thinking, we could do this. We could do this permanently, at least for a couple years, and see everything that the boys' friends are learning about in their textbooks, we could show them. So we decided to just do it.
Very cool. And it is very small quarters. Why did you pick this rig? I mean, you have the truck. You could have got a big fifth.
We didn't pick this rig. We actually picked the biggest Class A motorhome we could find with slides and whistles and bells and lots of things that could break. And we bought that, we flew to Florida and bought that and brought it home and worked on it for a year and took our first trip in it and we hated it. It just wasn't us at all. And my dad has had Airstreams for as long as I can remember, and we decided that that's really the only RV that we feel comfortable full-timing in for the abuse that we would be giving it.
And what is this rig? What is it?
It's a 30FB, so it's the bunkhouse model.
Okay, and what do you pull it with?
F-250, a 2011 F-250.
Is that diesel or gas?
It's a gas. 6.2.
And do you feel that it's okay, or does it feel like it needs help, or you think the vehicle's strong enough?
I think 95% of the time it's great.
Yeah.
There are times where I struggle with that, certainly in the hills up here in the mountains. It's not that it's a struggle. But I think if I had a diesel, there'd be much, much more oomph there.
Yeah.
So.
And boys, what do you think about this whole adventure?
Good. I'm excited to be seeing all the stuff that I'm learning about. And I just think it's really cool that we're going to get to see, like, the Grand Canyon and, like, Niagara Falls and all that cool stuff.
And what are we doing in regard to schooling?
Well, I quit a 17-year banking career to homeschool to be able to follow this dream. And so I bought a canned math program and a canned language arts program. And really, science and social studies and art and everything else has been national parks, state parks, just going to see sites. And we've done so much, and they have learned so much.
That's very cool.
So yeah, it seems to be working really well.
Yeah, and you had nothing else to do, put it more on your plate.
Yeah, I was very bored, so that was a good way to fill the hole.
I think it's really cool because you get to experience things that other kids that are their age would never, I mean, maybe on the 2 week vacation, maybe, but this is like living the dream.
And when do you guys do your schoolwork?
Usually in the morning, and it takes about like an hour or 2 hours.
Okay, very cool. Very cool.
Yeah, the bookwork doesn't take long at all, the math and language art stuff, and the beauty of it is that when we're going to national parks and we're hiking and we're participating in the Junior Ranger program, and they each have, I think, 22 badges.
I have no idea.
22 badges from the Junior Ranger program. It's school, but it's fun, and we're doing it together, and we're all learning.
What is the Junior Ranger program? Tell me about that.
It's a special program at national parks where the rangers will give you a book and you have to fill out activities and learn about the national park. And when you're done, they have you say a pledge and you get a small little badge.
Very cool.
And there's how many of them?
We each have 22 right now.
Wow.
That's amazing. I didn't even know that existed.
You know, that most people, when they get into their 40s and 50s, yeah, I think the average person probably goes to 2 or 3 national parks, and that's about it.
Yep.
Unless they're on one of these world tours like we are.
Yep. By the time you're 40, you've already done it all.
Much of that stuff covered already.
Yep.
I will go back to the question that you asked before about why we're doing what we're doing.
Uh-huh.
I think one of the big parts was when we were at home, you get caught in that rat race of work and all the extracurricular activities, and then by the time the day's over, you get maybe 1 hour with your children at night. And I think we kind of were struggling with that. And we were seeing time pass us by very quickly. So one of the things that we talked about was especially having the time now with them, undivided attention and experiencing this with them. Because at some point in their lives, they're going to want to go do other things.
You think?
And we're not going to be their priority.
You might not be part of it.
Might not.
But, you know, I know when they get older, they'll come back and they'll be more part of the family. But we wanted to share it with them now. So
that's very cool.
Yeah.
And now I understand you also have, who's staring at me here, a 90-pound lab. How does he fit into this small house?
beautifully. You know, it often looks like we have...
swing over and see Mr. Vader.
This is Darth Vader, known as Vader, or Vader Dog. He is a 90, almost 92-pound black lab, and
there he goes.
Just as much of a part of this family as the humans. So he, you know, we make room. He's huge, and he sheds all over the place. And
he goes wherever he wants because he's 90 pounds.
He's 90, yeah. He's got just as much of run of the place as we do. And, you know, we take him with us where we can, but he's so good that he's totally cool staying here and sleeping. In fact, he probably enjoys the peace once in a while. So he's a good buddy. His bed is the sofa. So everybody has a dedicated bed.
Well, ours take the sofa too.
Yeah, that's normal. I think that's normal.
So Shannon, do you work from the rig or what do you do?
I do. I work part-time. So I work 40 hours over 2 weeks. And it works out pretty good. I think it's a great balance with activities with the kids and being able to help still have an income coming in. Mm-hmm. I'm able to manage it however I see fit. So I can work at night. Generally, typically what I'll do is after the boys go to bed, I'll work at night. Or I'll work in the morning while they're doing school. So
I think that's a way better scenario than what I've got, because I'm still working. You know, I'm on the clock,
yeah.
9 to 5, let's call it. And being independent, being able to do that independently and make your own hours, that's a huge benefit.
It really makes it, for us, to be able to see what we want to see with them. It would be very hard to do it otherwise.
So I think having that, it's like, you know, I think the new term is location independent, but having that location independent lifestyle, whether you're a computer programmer or whatever you may be doing, mm-hmm. That gives you a lot of chance to go visit the things that right now we do our visiting on weekends.
Right.
So
when everybody else is doing their visiting.
And that's a really cool thing.
Okay, so while you were wondering if you would mind showing us around, just because of the fact that you have a very unique way of setting this up, being the fact that you have children mm-hmm. and adults and dogs. So if you wouldn't mind showing us around.
Absolutely.
Hey, so we're just coming into the entrance door of their beautiful Airstream, and we're going to check out and see how this thing's configured.
Okay, Okay, so this is a 2014 Flying Cloud 30FB. It's the bunk model. It's got a queen bed up front for mom and dad, and then it has a double bed and single bed on top, bunk beds in the back. So the bedrooms are separated on either side of the Airstream, which is nice.
Well, let's take a peek.
Yeah, come on in. I'll show you the back first. Okay, you want to show? Okay. Here, let's put the light on in here so they can really see. No. So this is the bunk room. We've got, you know, all of our Star Wars essentials.
Gotta have that.
So we've got a small nest up top that is Callum's. And then Quinn sleeps down here in the double bed. And there is still room for Legos, which is also
I see important. A wall full of medals.
Oh, yes. Those are the Junior Ranger badges.
Nice.
Yeah, they're doing a good job collecting.
What a cool experience.
Yeah, and so then this model has a fairly large pantry. I'm gonna open it. It's sure. Not clean. What this was there was a bar across the top for coats and stuff like that, which did not come in handy at all. So Shannon made these shelves for me to keep all of my big stuff. Printer and Instant Pot and toaster and random other things, some homeschool supplies. So that comes in really handy, all of our...
Nice woodwork, by the way.
I can't take complete credit for that. I got that off of another Airstream.
Yeah, that's true. Everything we do, we've seen in another Airstream.
Well, we all learn from each other.
It's a good community.
And then we have the corner bathroom, and one of the things I like the best about this is it's got, I think, one of the largest showers in... I'm going to actually show you my shower. So nice. It's got a decent-sized corner shower.
Bigger than ours.
It's very comfortable. Yeah, it is very comfortable. So that's nice to have in the corner bath. And then we got the Airstream without the oven because we didn't figure we'd use it. And we have the convection oven here. But honestly, the majority of the things that we cook are either grilled or instant potted. So that works out really well and gives us some extra storage space.
So did you custom order that or did you, was that on the lot?
We didn't. We lucked out. We were really, really hoping to get a 1 or 2 year old Airstream. And the day that we sold our motorhome in DC, this Airstream came on the market at Colonial. So we pretty much called him up and said, here's our credit card, that's my Airstream.
And everyone knows the guy at Colonial, right?
Did you say Colonial Airstream?
Everybody knows Colonial. That's right.
Botticelli?
Yes, absolutely. Actually, Lauren was who we talked to the most, so that was nice.
I like Patrick's videos.
That's a flex of Colonial.
Yeah, that's right. But they were great to work with, and yeah, and so we were lucky that we got a year and a half old model, so someone else could pay the depreciation for us.
Absolutely, that's very good.
So then in this model we have a wraparound dinette that fits all four of us. We had Thanksgiving dinner here and it was plenty of room. And then during the day the boys do their schoolwork here, and that seems to work out all right. And this is Vader's bed at night and of course just lounge space during the day. And then up front
I think Vader's gonna go try it out.
Yeah. All right, he's probably coming up here.
But that's a cool, nice, long couch.
It is, and we have storage underneath where all of our homeschool stuff is, and art supplies and everything. There's plenty of room. And then this is the master, which is a full-size queen bed. It's the, you know, the short RV model, but it seems to be big enough for us. And we have, you know, plenty of storage space. We have more than enough storage space, surprisingly. And still have some empty spots. And then this little fold-up table is where, this is Shannon's office.
Nice.
So during the day, he can unfold this and put it right in front of our sofa. And at night, it just hangs on our command hooks.
That's actually a great idea right there.
Yeah, yeah, it seems to work out well. It's $15 plastic, but it works.
Beautiful. Yep. Takes up no space.
Takes up no space. So this this is stock. This is as this model comes, but thanks to social media and Instagram in particular, We've been able to follow a lot of other folks with this same model that have done some really, really cool mods to it. There's one family that took out their queen bed up front and did two twins on either side and a bench in the back. So they've got older boys. So it gives them a little bit more space. And then mom and dad took the double bed in the back. There's another family with this model that took out the sofa completely and installed extra cabinet space, extra countertop, and a washer-dryer combo. So that's another very cool thing that you can do with this model.
I wonder where they put the washer-dryer at.
It's small enough that it fits under the cabinet.
Oh.
And then they've got, you know, a ton more counter space. And so there's lots of things. I mean, you know, the double bed in the back for someone who works from the road, to take out the two beds in the back and put an office back there and then have the master up front. That would work beautifully, I think, as well. It's tough to want to tear apart your rather expensive Airstream, but if it doesn't fit how you're using it, then I think there are a lot of mods that you can do to make it fit even better.
Yeah, I think we like this layout better than ours. And I think the difference is when you're in the showroom, everything feels good in the showroom.
Oh, absolutely. It's all beautiful.
And you're like, oh, this is so nice. And
absolutely.
And then you take it out and you're like, okay, there's really things that
you can't know really how you're going to need to use it until you're living in it every day. So far, this is fine for us.
this has got an awesome, because it's very versatile.
It is very versatile. It's laid out well.
Yep.
So I think that, like Shannon said, you know, this is a way for us to really be present in our kids' lives right now at this age, and our dog's life, also important. If anybody has any questions or has considered doing something similar, I would be honored to talk to them and try to convince them, because it is awesome. It is as awesome. All of the same issues that you have in house, you bring with you. You know, your kids argue, you need a little space or whatever. Nothing's different, even though it's only 200 square feet. It's, it's still, it's better.
But your backyard is different every day.
We have a beautiful backyard. And if we don't like our backyard, we change it.
And one of the best things, at least for us, is that there aren't the distractions of everyday life, right? So you have undivided attention to your kids, to your wife, to your family. And that was the most important thing to us at this point in our life. The one thing that I can say is that if you're on the fence about doing this as a lifestyle change, it can be pretty overwhelming. It can be scary. And it took us a while to gear up for this. It didn't happen overnight. It happened pretty quickly once the process started. But knowing what we know now, I don't think we would ever change anything for the world. Mm-hmm. We would never do anything different. We'd do it sooner than what we did. And hopefully it will last for a while. So.
So Shannon, the breadwinner, how are you bringing the bread into this house?
Actually, pretty easily. So what I did is, when we first were going to go on the road, one of the things that really, really concerned me was having a connection on the road. And I didn't come up with this by myself. I did a lot of research and bothered a lot of other guys who were already on the road and doing this to kind of gain some insight on how they put together their working rig. So I'll go through it real quick, and it's pretty simple. I'm just using a Weboost 4G X amplifier or booster, which then comes in and ties to my hotspot, my MiFi. And I've kind of got these placed together because this is the internal antenna. So what it does is I put a omnidirectional omnidirectional on the roof. And I ran all my cables in through the refrigerator vent and brought them down and just brought them through a pre-existing hole here in the wall. And that allows me to bring my booster to an internal antenna that then distributes that signal directly out to my MiFi when I need it. And from that MiFi, I have actually tied it into a Soho router, which allows me to have my own private network internal. So we can all connect to that router, not have to change network names or worry about things. That also allows me to pick up the local Wi-Fi from the campground and create a secure network behind that firewall. So that's basically the gist of it. It's pretty straightforward, very easy to install yourself. I had a lot of reservations about doing that. But if you use the refrigerator vent, I know guys that have actually pulled the vent off. They popped the rivets and just pulled the vent out and ran the cables down. I chose to take the easy way out, and I actually pulled my refrigerator out, ran the cables down, and that gave me access to everything behind there, and it was very, very simple. So I just wanted to show you guys that, and I don't take credit for that. There's a lot of guys out there that are running this, and I basically stole most of the ideas from them and put it together. So
did you put everything up on the roof as well?
I did. I mounted everything myself, yes.
That's amazing.
So
this is quite a setup you have.
It has actually allowed us to work from many places that we could not have worked before. So
babe, you gotta do this.
I can basically have a 1x text signal is basically what I have, or extended signal. And if I turn my booster on, I can pretty much get 3 bars LTE, maybe 3 bars 3G or 3 bars LTE, depending on what exists.
And have you ever gone any place that it's like really hard to get signal and you've been able to get it because of your setup?
I have actually. One of the first places that we camped in Asheville, I needed this and I could not have worked on the road from there. There have been other instances where I just could not get a signal at all. So like Padre Island, we were 18 miles from the nearest cell tower. So there was no way we were going to pick up a signal.
Yeah. But don't you love driving down the road and you see the tower? It's right next to you and you still don't have a signal.
Sure.
Do you not see the tower?
But yes, it has given us the ability to camp in many places we could not have.
So Shannon, when you say you hang out in Padre Island and things like that, how can you do that when you don't have any hookups? What are you using for electricity?
So we have a small solar setup, which is 100 watts right now. We have 250 watt panels, which is, I think, the stock system that Airstream installs from the factory on these older models. It's not a lot, but it definitely is enough to dry camp for a little while. So about a week ago, we came from Bandelier State Park, National Monument, and we dry camped for 6 days, and it was awesome. The trouble with it was, though, the first 3 days were great, but the last 3 days I found myself having to run the generator more and more to charge my batteries back to full capacity. With running computers, charging one or two laptops plus iPads, we don't do TV time or anything like that when we boondock. It's just strictly trying to work and survive. We found that we possibly needed a little bit more. So I'm in the process of going, we leave tomorrow to go over to a place called Backcountry Solar. And we are going to upgrade with another additional 200 watts of portable panels. And I'm also going to have my charge controller replaced because I have the stock charge controller, which is only a 25 amp charge controller. I think I'm going to replace it with a 40 amp charge controller, which will allow me to add the 200 watts plus have plenty of room to expand if I find that 300 watts isn't enough. So we chose to go with a portable because it's an easier install. I don't have to replace any of the existing wiring if I go any more than 100 watts on the roof. Other than that, it's pretty straightforward. I'm going to get a better charge controller. I'm going to replace my batteries with Trojan T105s. So that will almost double my amp hour capacity for my batteries. So it will allow us to go a longer period of time. There will be another modification. I'll have to deepen my battery box because the current box isn't tall enough to fit those new batteries.
So if anybody has any questions or wants to talk to us about it, we are on Instagram. I am Alumalarkey, A-L-U Malarkey, and he is Mr. _
Alumalarkey.
Alumalarkey.
Original.
And then our blog is www.alumalarkey.com.
There you go. Well, thank you guys very much for letting us intrude in your home, showing us around, and meeting all of you, because we have a lot of followers that are interested in the people that we have met through our travels. And I know you have a lot of people that follow you that have probably always wanted to know a little bit more about you. So thank you very much for letting us into your house.
Well, you're so welcome.
Very cool.
We'll be right back.